Microlecture number 10, Africa in the Early Modern Period. At the beginning of the Early Modern Period, from 1500 to 1650, some regions of the African continent were becoming increasingly involved in international trade with the Far East, the Middle East, and Europe. The two most important areas were the Mediterranean seaboard in the north and the Red Sea and Indian Ocean coastlines in the east. In the east, the African kingdom of Ethiopia extended from Massawa in the north to several tributary states in the south. Still, the ruling Solomonic dynasty in Ethiopia, in power since the 13th century, faced several external threats. Ethiopia was a Christian kingdom that practiced Coptic Christianity, an orthodox form of the Christian faith that originated in Egypt about 42 and 45 CE. By the early 1500s, Ethiopia was a Christian society surrounded by many different Muslim states. Besides Ethiopia, on the eastern coast of the continent, there were also Swahili city states. The word Swahili means people of the coast and refers to the people living along the East African coast and the nearby islands. The people living in these territories were speakers of the African language Bantu. However, they were greatly influenced by the Arab culture that dominated the southern Mediterranean Sea. They were also influenced by Indian, Indonesian, Persian, and Chinese culture. The Swahili civilization was overwhelmingly maritime. They lived in a fertile, well-watered, and intensively cultivated stretch of land extending down the coast with plenty of resources. The region's prosperity was based on its trade and commerce. The Swahili act as middlemen in an Indian Ocean East African economy that can be described as early capitalism. The Swahili exchanged cloves, ivory, rhinoceros horns, tortoise shells, inland ebony chairs, dried coconut, and inland slaves for Arabian and Persian perfumes, toilet articles, ink and paper, Indian textiles, beads, and iron tools, and for Chinese porcelain and silks. The Swahili city-states were very cosmopolitan. Places like Mogadishu, Pate, Lamu, Mombasa, and Kilwa enjoy a worldwide reputation for commercial prosperity and high living standards. With the arrival of the Portuguese, the situation of the Swahili city-states changed completely. Even though some Swahili city-states built alliances with the Europeans, most of them were bombarded and attacked. The Portuguese ended up building forts, fortified markets, and trading posts that serve as the foundation of their commercial networks with India and China. In the late 17th century, pressures from the northern European maritime powers, Dutch, French, and English, combined with local African rebellions, collapsed the Portuguese influence in Africa. From the 1550s, English and French became big, dangerous rivals of the Portuguese. Initially, only individual French traders were active, but the French crown was not directly involved. In fact, on several occasions, the royal house tried to stop their subjects from making expeditions to Africa as they did not want to have problems with the Portuguese. During the early 1560s, English and French trading companies sent several expeditions to Africa. They traded many things, but the product that helped them the most were firearms, which the Portuguese had prohibited since the beginning of their colonial enterprise. In any case, it seems possible that at the time, both English and French found that looting Iberian ships on Atlantic waters was more profitable than trading with Africa. It was within this context that the Dutch made their appearance on the African shores. They were in war with Spain and repudiated the Pope's subdivision of the Atlantic. They believed that Portugal and Spain were the enemies and considered Africa a battleground of that confrontation. The vast capital amassed by traders and their strong fleet made it possible for the Dutch to expand to India and Africa on a scale not yet achieved by the English or the French. Some scholars even consider that the expeditions were enterprises already organized by prominent capitalists who could invest their capital for extended periods of time. The Portuguese were no rivals for the Dutch, who could supply large quantities of goods at a low price because of their wealth and efficient trade networks. In this respect, they had the edge over the English and the French. Dutch imports into West Africa consist of iron, brass, copper, and tinware, cheap textiles of diverse origins, spirits, weapons, among other things. The African native population paid these goods in gold extracted from the interior of the continent. By 1617, the Dutch were already the European power dominating the northwestern coast of Africa, eliminating the Portuguese, the French, and the English. They held their strong position there for over 30 years. Initially, the Dutch, just as the French and the English, were not interested in the slave trade. However, the turn of the 16th century heralded a new phase of European expansion in Africa, in which the slave trade grew in significance to become of the utmost importance. Through this period, Central Africa was of little interest to the Europeans. The Portuguese did not penetrate the interior of the continent, neither the other European powers. Most of their action remained concentrated on the coast of the continent. In Africa's southern tip, the first signs of European expansions appeared during the 17th century in the form of colony of Dutch and German peasants, called the Boers. They were settlers sponsored by the Dutch East India Company. In the early modern period, Africa experienced the eruption of European powers who were hungry for resources. The European intervention in the continent changed the history of the area and transformed the Atlantic economy by making it the strongest and more important in the world. This is all we have for today. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.